Let the buyer beware. Usually good advice. Even so, it helps if the consumer has someone watching his or her back. Aaron Moriarty of 48 Hours has been talking to the embattled head of the federal agency that's trying to do just that.
You all have failed. Failed once again to respond adequately to this subpoena.
Of course we've responded. We've produced another, I think, 20,000 pages of documents.
Richard Cordray may be the best friend that the consumer has ever had. So why does he seem to have so many enemies on Capitol Hill?
Do you feel you have a target on your back?
Well, what I feel is that we need an independent consumer watchdog. You have regular people who have problems with big financial companies. How do they get relief? And you need somebody who's going to stand on their side and level the playing field for them.
Cordray is a former attorney general of Ohio, and thanks to an exceptional gift of recall, a five-time winner of the TV show Jeopardy.
It's set in Massachusetts. Richard.
What is the Bostonians?
Correct.
But he raised hackles of some in Washington when President Obama appointed him director of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, or the CFPB.
You're an attorney, and you just said that it doesn't matter what they signed.
It doesn't matter to the...
Since then, he's been rebuked and criticized on Capitol Hill.
Who is to protect the consumer from the director of the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau?
That's just not true. I'm no different from the Federal Reserve or the FDIC.
The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau was created in 2010 as part of legislation designed to rein in Wall Street. The Bureau was actually the idea of Elizabeth Warren, a Harvard professor at the time, who hoped that a single independent agency regulating all consumer lending would prevent the kind of practices that led to the Great Recession of 2008.
We cover banks, we cover auto lenders, we cover mortgage lenders. Nobody was singularly focused on that before the financial crisis, and it was a gap and a blind spot, and it cost this country terribly.
In less than 6 years, Cordray has turned the fledgling agency into a regulatory powerhouse, rewriting lending regulations and bringing enforcement actions against some of the biggest financial institutions in the country, including Wells Fargo, Citibank, and Bank of America. Still, some members of Congress say Cordray has way too much power.
We have now one unelected, one unaccountable individual who essentially gets to determine what mortgages we have, what credit cards we have, what bank loans we get.
Jeb Hensarling, Republican from Texas, is chairman of the House Financial Services Committee.
In a democracy, no one person should have that much power.
There you go.
Outside of Washington, people like Harry Boris and his son Ari see it differently.
The Bureau is needed, and it needs to be strengthened, not weakened, and it needs to protect people that can't look out for themselves.
Harry contacted the Bureau's Complaint Center in 2011, concerned about a used car loan his 19-year-old son had gotten after joining the Army.
He picked me up at the airport in this big Dodge truck. I noticed that he was completely broke, he didn't have money to eat.
Ari got the loan through a program called MILES, Military Installment Loans and Educational Services.
They were going to teach soldiers how to buy an automobile in a responsible way.
Because the monthly car payment was deducted directly from his Army paycheck, Ari mistakenly assumed his loan was part of a government program.
You go in the dealership, too, and they have pictures of, like, the post commander and all these battalion commanders in full uniform shaking the hands of the car dealer. So they really make it look like, and they made it look like this is part of the military, like the Army.
Ari Boris had agreed to pay three times the Blue Book value of the truck over the lifetime of the contract.
I'm not saying he was right, but they were wrong to allow things like that to happen.
Altogether, if he had kept that loan for his $11,000 car, he would have paid $31,405.80.
That's about right.
Harry got his son out of the loan, and the Bureau got refunds for Ari Boris and 50,000 other members of the military who had signed up for similar overpriced loans.
I met two of his friends that had also done the same thing. And incidentally, one of them had asked to go to Iraq or Afghanistan just to get the hazard pay to pay his car loan.
Since its inception, the Bureau has collected nearly $12 billion in restitution and fines. $12 billion. But Congressman Hensarling argues that the Bureau's actions have also hurt consumers, forcing some lenders out of business and making others less willing to make loans.
If you have law that is gray as opposed to black and white, what happens is, as one banker told me, I'm just hunkering down in a foxhole and I'm not lending money because I'm afraid of what the CFPB may do.
The Financial Choice Act.
The Financial Choice Act.
To reduce regulations that he says stifle the economy, Hensarling is now pushing a bill, the Financial Choice Act, that would restructure the CFPB and strip it of much of its enforcement powers.
Is it possible that one of the reasons why there are members of Congress who want to get rid of Richard Cordray and his bureau is that maybe he's just doing his job too well?
That's always a possibility.
William D. Cohen spent 17 years as an investment banker and now writes about Wall Street for Vanity Fair magazine.
I personally think it just goes back to the antipathy that fellow senators have and congresspeople have for Elizabeth Warren. This is her baby. I think they just want to zing her a little bit.
In June, Hensarling's bill passed its first hurdle in the House, despite strong opposition by consumer groups and concerned academics.
You received a letter signed by 158 professors from all the major universities in this country, all opposing your bill, all supporting the Bureau. Are all of those professors wrong?
Yes.
They are. They're all wrong.
Obviously, they don't believe in freedom. They don't believe in capitalism. They don't believe in consumer prosperity. They ultimately don't. They obviously don't believe in markets.
I'm offended. I believe in freedom.
Christopher Peterson, a law professor at the University of Utah, and several of the letter writers met with us at Georgetown University.
It seems to me that Chairman Hensarling believes in freedom, but only for big banks and financial institutions. What about the consumers who end up in debt traps?
Patricia McCoy of Boston College.
Even the Choice Act would not abolish the Bureau. Instead, it would just leave it an empty husk.
Kathleen Engel of Suffolk University Law School.
We all lived through the financial crisis, and anybody studying the crisis understands that the failure of the federal regulators to protect consumers was the most important government failure that we have seen since the Great Depression.
Adam Levitin of Georgetown Law.
The Bureau has been very careful and selective about its enforcement actions. It's not gone after businesses where there's a close call.
The battle over the Bureau isn't over yet. It now moves to the U.S. Senate and the federal courts, where the CFPB has been challenged as unconstitutional.
Please welcome CFPB Director.
And despite speculation that Richard Cordray may soon resign to run for governor of Ohio, he says his attention remains on the American consumer.
Making sure people are treated fairly in the marketplace, that somebody stands on their side to see that that happens, that's our job, and we're going to keep focusing on it.